It's really difficult to get people to think critically about the internet through a story or a film about illegal downloading, because everyone just wants all that stuff for free. But if I talk about books, people understand that it takes a lot of effort to write books and that authors have some kind of rights over their books. So if I focus on that, people will understand that not everything is right, not everything is going right, not everything is acceptable, not everything is inevitable about the internet. I focused on Google Books. And the other really good story, the Google Books story, what made it really good was that ultimately, small, you know, collections of authors from around the world had opposed Google. And in quite conventional ways, they'd opposed Google. They'd, you know, written emails, they'd created petitions, they'd written to their governments. And, you know, eventually this had gone to court. There'd been a court case in America, and it involved governments, and it involved the Department of Justice, and it involved individual publishers and whatever else. And these people had actually forced Google to abandon its original master plan. And I thought, you know, that's great. I don't really want to criticize Google, but this is, I want to criticize the internet. But this is a really good story, and it shows that actually, you know, you and I, ordinary people, we can exercise some kind of control over the future of the internet and over our future. Mixture of medieval kingship and, you know, modern totalitarianism. That was the attraction. It was so exotic. It had so little to do with socialism. And I thought that it was just so fantastical. It was like a sort of fantasy, political history or politics as a kind of fantasy. That's what interested me. It was almost like they'd written a fairy tale and now they were trying to create a regime or a political system that followed the outlines of that fairy tale. Well, I'd been to Romania before because I followed, when I was making a film about the European Union, I made a comedy about the European Union in 2000 called Are You EU? And we followed these MEPs, these European politicians to Romania before it was a member of the EU on a fact-finding mission. And so that was my first encounter with Romania, and we went to the People's Palace, you know, in Bucharest, and it was all just so amazing. And I started reading about Ceausescu. And there was another very good film called East Side Story about musicals in East Germany. That was a kind of influence as well, you know it, yeah. And I thought, you know, all this, wouldn't it be interesting? I've got a degree in art history. Wouldn't it be interesting to look at the artistic output of this political system, of Romania's political system? And it was much more colourful in a way than East Germany's or something. That was the idea, to look at politics as a work of art. I worked with Alexandru Solomon, you know, who made this fantastic film, The Great Communist Bank Robbery. And I've seen the autobiography of Nicolae Ceausescu, which is a superb film. Much better than the one I made, you know. I think I have the same expectations of Romanian documentaries as I would have of British or German documentaries. I expect you to look at the past in critical ways and new ways, and I expect you to examine your present also in interesting and imaginative ways. I mean, documentaries should tell new stories in new ways, and they should be very, very critical, but if possible, they should also have a warm feeling towards an understanding towards the people in them. You know, but I've done lots of things in my life. You know, I mean, life's an adventure. And sometimes I think I'll give up documentary filmmaking and become a teacher, you know. I should do something completely different from now on. I mean, I never studied film. I think my films would be much better if I had studied film, but I've never studied film, you know. But shit, I worked at MTV, I was a DJ, I was trendy, you know, it was my 20s, I took drugs, I had a little record label. And then, you know, I got into the art world and I was an art critic for 2 years. And then I made a film investigating the art market and I lost all my friends in the art world. You know, I mean, you only live once, you know, at least in this particular, you only live once and, you know, life's a bit of an adventure, as long as you can kind of pay your bills. And it's a bit of a journey of discovery. And in a way, I don't think any of us know what we're good at. I just got drawn to something that I was good at and something that I believed in. Like, I love watching films, I love watching documentaries, so why not do it? We have a problem, don't we? We documentary filmmakers and people in the documentary world, is that every day we meet loads of people who tell us that they love documentaries, and yet when we try and get people to pay for our films, whether it's individuals going to the cinema or television channels, they say, I'm sorry, No one watches documentaries. We can't get an audience for documentaries. We can only get an audience for quiz shows or Big Brother or popular drama. And I think that it's a big issue for us how to overcome that contradiction. And some people say, oh, well, no one watches documentaries. It's the end of the world for documentary filmmakers. Forget it. And other people say, no, the problem is that we have to create, we have to monetize. Romania's changed. You know, the European Union, 20 years of development, it's not the same place, but it's still just as exciting and magical and intelligent and exotic for me as it used to be then. I mean, I love coming to Romania. I'd like to have an excuse to come here for 6 months and become fluent in Romanian. I'm a Jew, and an eighth of my blood is Romanian. Others are bits of me are Polish and German. I don't feel very British. And Romania, like, I feel at home in Berlin, I feel at home in Poland, and I feel at home in Romania. So I love coming here. I think it is a problem if you allow one institution to gain access to vast amounts of information of any kind and to have a monopoly over that. I mean, if, as we know, if the National Security Agency, if the American state can read all of our emails of any individual on the planet and analyze all our search results and see all our Facebook entries and analyze all that data, then, you know, they will have a power that will be dangerous, and we should stop that happening.